Pardon the interruption, but I'm Pablo Torre. And Tony, the Curiosity rover has spent 3,000 days on Mars.
I'm Tony Kornheiser. It wouldn't last a minute near Uranus. Now, the great benefit of Wilbon not being here
yes.
is that the rest of us understand that that's funny, and Mike would just go, ah, ha, 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 ha. But it's funny.
Tony, it's more than funny. It's a bucket list item for me. I didn't think I'd ever get this opportunity to actually hear you say that to me. So thank you so much for making my Friday and possibly my 2021.
Just wonderful. Welcome to PTI, boys and girls. Wilbon is out, so we are lucky to be joined by my grandson, the host of the ESPN Daily Podcast, Mr. Pablo Torre. Yeah! Woo! Cheers are always good, and we begin today with the highest profile game of the weekend, Tom Brady versus Drew Brees on Sunday, combined ages 85. It got to 85 today when Brees celebrated his 42nd birthday. One other combination of note is combined touchdown passes, 1,052, because Brady is number one all time and Brees is number two. Pablo, which quarterback do you think is going to come out on top?
I want to pick Drew Brees here, Tony, and I say that with full acknowledgement that Drew Brees is not only in his mid-40s by now, he's still recovering from, I think, about a dozen, like, broken ribs. I fully right. acknowledge also that he is, I think, second to last in the NFL in terms of air yards on his passes, all of which is to say that he can't really throw the ball at all. But I still want that guy because, number one, the system he plays in, they're humming again, right? Michael Thomas back from injury, all the limitations on Drew Brees' arm, Sean Payton, they've been dealing with that for years. None of that stuff is new. He's been banged up for years. That's not new. But the Tom Brady thing, right? Last week against the Washington football team, he got away with some stuff. He was supposed to be pressured by that defense. He was not. But when Tom Brady is pressured, he goes from fifth in QBR, Tom Brady-esque, to 31st, which is Nick Mullins-esque. So this Saints defense with Trey Hendrickson, who had admitted, he had as many sacks as Aaron Donald, Tony, second most in the NFL. Against that guy, give me Drew Brees on the other side.
Okay, so you want to pick Brees, and you will pick Brees. Do I have that
yes.
correct? Even
That's
with
correct.
His physical limitations, you will pick him.
Even with all of
it. I want to pick Brady. I love Brady. It doesn't mean I don't love Brees. I love Brees both on and off the field. But Brady is a miracle to me. He's 43 years old, and he had, to this point, 42 touchdown passes so far this season. That, to me, is incredible. I believe that Chris Godwin will catch passes this week and not drop them like he did. Mm. And I find myself rooting for Brady, but if you ask me who I'm going to pick, I have to say to you that Brees is 5-2 all-time in the NFL against Brady. He's 2-0 this year against Brady, and in those games, and I want to get this correct,
please.
Brady has 2 touchdowns and 5 picks. You know, everyone says it's really hard to win, to beat a team 3 times in a row, but it's not if you're the better team. I think Sean Payton is the better coach. I want Brady to win, but I think of Brady now, and this is before your time, obviously, as sort of like Joe Montana when he went to Kansas City. And he won
yes.
some playoff games, but he never got back to the Super Bowl. And Brady's been great lately, Pablo, absolutely great. In his last 5 games, he's got 14 touchdowns and 1 pick. But I somehow
yeah.
think it's going to be Brees as well. I do. So,
Tony, I want to ask you about some of the other news we're getting right now, because the teams that failed to make the playoffs have made some hires. The Falcons have hired Titans offensive coordinator Arthur Smith as their new head coach, and the Jets last night announced that they've hired 49ers defensive coordinator Robert Saleh as their replacement for Adam Gase. So it's been 5 straight losing seasons for the Jets now, including the last one at 2-14. So, Tony, should their long, long-suffering fans have reason for optimism?
So you live in New York. You're closer to this circumstance than I am, although mm-hmm. all my life I rooted for the Jets when I was a kid, even before Joe Namath. I think the appropriate question for Robert Saleh is very simple. Do you have any players? Because I don't think you have any players. Okay, you're not sure who your quarterback is going to be. You don't have a single guy under contract who has ever been to the Pro Bowl. The Jets stink. I mean, there's just no getting around it. So I don't know. He's supposed to be a rah-rah guy, very enthusiastic. Players on the 49ers played for him. They love him. I'm for that. I'm happy for him. But you have to have players. You have to have players.
No, look, the big picture answer here is, of course, there should not be optimism for the New York Jets. Tony, that psychological scar tissue I sensed in your voice there indicates as much,
yes.
Right? It takes a lot more than a new fancy rah-rah hire to change a franchise that has been steeped in misery, and most recently steeped in misery because their ownership, right? The Johnson family, they don't know what they're doing, right? They are the guys who empowered Adam Gase. They are the guys now who are picking a replacement, which is promising, except that those guys at the top are still very much there. But the optimism and the case for it, here's where I can see it, Tony. Head coach in the NFL is such a political job, right? It's not merely having a good sense of the scheme and X's and O's. It's being the front-facing aspect of an organization. It is, in fact, getting the people in your building to really like and root for you. This guy seems to have that. And the deficit the Jets have entered this coming season with because of Gase, that means a very low bar has been set for him to have, at the very least, a nice, easy beginning to this.
So I'm going to talk as somebody who's old here and who followed the Jets pretty much my whole life, even before Joe Namath. Okay, they have one highlight ever, and it's Joe Namath doing this as they win the Super Bowl in 1969, which the last time I looked, is like more than 50 or is it 60 years ago? However long ago it is.
Yeah.
That's what they've got. And I'll give you some names, and I'll tell you what they all have in common. Todd Bowles, Rex Ryan, Eric Mangini, Al Groh, Herm Edwards. What they have in common is they could have no sustained excellence with the Jets. The Jets haven't been in the Super Bowl in much longer than you're alive. Much
Correct.
Longer than you're alive. So to say that Salah can turn that around, good luck. Via con Dios, I hope you can. I don't think so. Chris Haynes of Yahoo is reporting that the reason the Rockets traded James Harden to the Nets instead of trading him to the 76ers is because Houston owner Tillman Fertitta refused to deal with 76ers GM Daryl Morey, who until a few months ago held that same title with the Rockets and worked for Fertitta. That is really holding a grudge. Pablo, did Tillman Fertitta help or hurt himself?
Hurt himself, Tony. And I notice you are sitting in front of, you know, books that you've done in the past like you have. I just want to point out, Tillman Fertitta wrote a book too. It is called Shut Up and Listen! Exclamation point. His face glowering out at the world. That's the guy who decided to hold this grudge against his own best interests because he did not want to reward Daryl Morey, his former employee, from stealing, number one, James Harden, and number two, his own pride. Ben Simmons is the key to any hypothetical win when James Harden says, I want out. Ben Simmons, Tony, look, I love him more than anybody else on this network, but Ben Simmons is an all-NBA player, a franchise cornerstone guy. If you had the chance to get him, and you didn't, which, by the way, I was under the understanding that he would not have traded for Ben Simmons simply because of this grudge as of November. The fact that he didn't is irresponsible, honestly.
So what I'll get to is how much I love this story, because I like a guy who will hold a grudge. I like a guy who will cut off his nose to spite his own face. But let's get to Ben Simmons, because what is true here, there is reporting that Ben Simmons was not offered for trade, and there is reporting that Ben Simmons was offered
yes.
for trade. If indeed Ben Simmons was offered and you did not take him, you are hurting yourself, not helping yourself, because he's better than Oladipo. He's better than anything that came from the Nets. But he's a player who could be indeed a great player. So if Tillman Fertitta did that, that's just crazy, because you're hurting yourself. What the Nets gave you, they gave you thin air. They gave you draft picks. They may be great, but they may not be great. Ben Simmons goes out there, and he's a player worth having. But again, I have to say, Fertitta must hate Morey beyond comprehension.
Oh, yes.
To do this,
oh, Tony.
To actually tie his own hands behind his own back.
Yes, he hated that Daryl Morey said, I got to go step away to spend time with my family, and then took a gap week. And then reemerge with another team saying, by the way, I want your best player. He hated that, absolutely.
So I will say this, regardless of how the trade came about. We're going to be talking about this trade for a long time. We're going to look at Houston to see if they're conceivably as good or better without Harden, because Harden didn't want to play and ruin the chemistry on that particular team. We're going to look at the chemistry of the Nets with Harden and Durant, and if Kyrie Irving ever plays. This is the story of the NBA season this year.
Absolutely.
And to not make that trade out of spite, while I admire it, is nuts. Let's take a break. Coming up, Baker.